So I'm not going to do 412 since it just came out today. I'm not feeling that lucky. I was having some problems earlier when I was like kind of rehearsing through this stuff with 411 crashing on me. It's some weird Mac metal issue. I don't know what it is, but if we run into that tonight, then I might try 412 or I might just try 410. But we'll see. Hopefully, fingers crossed, we won't run into any issues there. So that being said, let's just go ahead and get our project going. So yeah, we're gonna work off the scenario that we're at a game jam. We got our theme. Can anybody kick out like a good game jam theme that we could work off of or anything like that? Like, I don't know. Video game of the future. All right. That sounds like a game jam theme. It's pretty broad with plenty of room for interpretation. Where is my editor? Before I hit launch. There we go. It's funny that if you guys have visited the official Unreal Engine Slack channel, they had last week, they called it the what was it called, Josh's
Yeah, that bot jam.
bot jam. Yeah, and I didn't have a chance to participate, but I did use the bot to generate a few ideas, and one of them was it's you're saving the environment by driving like an electric car, but the problem is you keep teleporting. Like that was that idea. And what's one that you came up with? Yeah. So we got to get down on that one of these days. Anyway, I'm gonna make a blank project. I'm sorry, not blank, but a third person templated project. That's what we're gonna work from for the purposes of this. And then I want starter content because we're gonna be using some of that to, again, we're prototyping here or we're doing a game jam, so we want to have everything available to us. We might have some people on our team. I don't know, maybe we have Mike working on some art for us. Maybe we have somebody from Time Fire doing some animation, something like that. And they're off doing their own thing, but we got to make sure that we're still effective and that we can deliver some gameplay logic and mechanics while they're doing their thing. So let's just make let's see. Project here. Also, I passed around a little bit earlier a cheat sheet for keyboard shortcuts and chords in the Blueprint editor. That cheat sheet is, I printed that out from this blog posting here from a while back. You can see the URL hopefully on the projector. If not, I also posted it to the Meetup for tonight's Meetup. But if you just scroll down a little bit, then you'll get the actual cheat sheet that you can get in the PDF that you can print off on your own if you need one. One thing to note is that there's a bunch of chords that you can use to speed up creating nodes in the Blueprint editor. There's one that wasn't listed in this list that I found somewhere else. And basically what it does is if you have an actor selected in your level and you want to quickly create a reference to it in the Blueprint editor, you can hit the R key and then click the left mouse button to get a reference to that in the Blueprint editor. So I wrote that on a few of these, but just keep that in mind that there's a couple commands that might be missing from this, as this is kind of an older blog posting here. All right, so it looks like we're good to go. We're inside. This is your vanilla third party, or sorry, third person template. So if I hit play here, my guy, he can run around, jump backwards, I guess. And that's pretty much it. Nothing else really going on here. But we want to kind of take this and we want to box off some gameplay features or experiment with some things to try to get our game of the future working and moving along. So with that, and speaking about key bindings, we'll get started with that. So I don't know how many of you have been in a blueprint editor and, you know, you create a blueprint. Let's just open the level blueprint here. Let's just stock that up here. And you're adding nodes. Let's see, we want begin play because we don't have that showing up here yet. Bam, there's our begin play node. Now we can start dragging off other nodes and doing other things. Well, a lot of times there's a shortcut to either creating a node or just getting around the blueprint editor in general. So instead of dropping that begin play, what I can do is I can go to my cheat sheet here, and there's actually a chord that's optimized. So if I hold down the P button and click, well, there's my begin play. So I didn't have to, you know, right click, bring it up, search. So just keep that in mind. Like, you know, that's one way to kind of optimize your workflow is to figure out, you know, how to quickly create other nodes. What you can do with that is some other ones we see on here is if I need to make a branch, I got to make a decision right away. Then I can just hold down the B button and click. There's a branch node, and I can start working off of that. So there's plenty of those you can use. Yeah. There were some being passed around. There might be a couple more left. Did everybody grab one? Yeah, if you're sitting next to somebody, you might want to kind of share, because I think I had like six or seven that went out. So the other place where you can go to kind of either look at your current key bindings or set up new ones is in the editor preferences. If you go to preferences and then you go to keyboard shortcuts, this is the master list of every single. Hey, Dave, welcome. These are all of the key bindings that the editor knows about, and the vast majority of them are empty. So you have like full freedom to come in here and set up these key bindings however you want. So if I drop down spawn nodes by chord, well, these are the ones that I was just talking about here. And this is actually how I found that our chord that's missing from this sheet is I went in here and I took a look at what was already being mapped. And I said, oh, if you hold down the R and you click, then you can get whatever active reference and drop it into the blueprint graph. So yeah, literally every section of the editor has keys that are available in here. And the one that I was actually looking for earlier that I thought would be useful, especially for this presentation, let's see if I can find it. In 4.10 or 4.11, they added support for aligning blueprint nodes to kind of clean things up a little bit and get rid of some of that spaghetti. And so far, I've not seen any bindings for those anywhere, so I don't know if anybody else has ever encountered those at all, but to do that. Oh, did he? So they're not represented here anywhere. Let's see. Yeah, and that's exactly what I was looking for. You read my mind. But it doesn't look like it. I'm not going to spend a lot of time in here. But we might bind some keys at some point. Right now, we might come back to that a little bit later. There's another thing in here that I found that's very, very useful when you're, you know, dealing with blueprints in a blueprint editor, and that is, oh, it is under which? There we are, graph editor. Oh man, that's money. All right, so let's see, what should we do? What's a good, let's do Command-Alt-S. I don't think that's bound to anything else. Another one I would find useful would be to, exactly. Let's find out. I use Control S, so let's try that for align bottom. There.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yep. It does allow you to do that if you want. So let's do top with Command Alt T, and let's do bottom with Command Alt B, and that's all we'll do for now. And as soon as you assign those, you're good to go. If you want to get rid of them, just hit the X button and it's unassigned. So the other setting in here that I found particularly useful, let's just look at it by way of example first. If I'm in here and I'm plotting out my level, and I don't know, maybe the first thing I want to do is like spawn some actors somewhere. Anytime you're in the blueprint editor, whether you're like me and you're on Mac and you're hoping it's not going to crash, or you add a new variable and you have to compile a blueprint in order to be able to set defaults and otherwise manipulate that variable, you obviously got to compile. And we know from our cheat sheet that the fastest way to compile is hit the F7 key. So F7. It doesn't like this one because I don't have some stuff plugged in, but it doesn't really matter. You hit F7, we're compiled, but the thing is, our blueprint is still not saved yet. So it would really be useful if when we hit compile, it automatically saved our blueprint for us, so we didn't have to say compile and then save. So in order to get around that, there's two ways you can set that option. One option is to just go into the preferences and then go down to blueprint editor. If you go down to compiler, there's a save on compile option here in the drop down. You want to take that to either on success only or to always. On success only just means that if there's no errors, then it'll save the blueprint. Always, it means that even if there are errors, it will save the blueprint anyway. Since I like playing it fast and loose, I'll pick always. Why not? It might crash on me anyway, so we'll see. The other way to get to that option is to simply drop down this compile drop down here next to the compile button. And the tooltip is a little bit in the way there, but there's a save on compile option is there as well. So let's make sure that option is set appropriately. Not that I've seen. It would be useful if it went back the other way, but I think their intended flow is to go from compile and then save from there. So maybe that's not why they do that. So anyway. Now, if we hit F7 to compile, maybe I need to make a modification before I compile. All right, it did not do what it should have done, and that's disabled. I ran into this earlier, and I wonder if it's because I don't have a save in my toolbar button. That's the reason why. Let's just save the level and try that again. That makes sense. All right, that makes sense. So let's grab a blueprint that we know is not a level blueprint, like the third person character, which is this guy right here. Right, this guy's already he wants to be modified, so we'll hit F7 to compile. And there you go, now it's saved. So that's a pretty useful shortcut, so you don't have to say compile save every time or worry that you didn't save whenever you did a compile. So now I want to talk a little bit about some of the ways that we reduce code duplication inside the blueprint editor. In software engineering, there's the so-called DRY principle, which is don't repeat yourself. And again, as I mentioned earlier, you don't want to do that because if you duplicate a bunch of graph nodes all over your blueprint and then you need to go change some functionality that needs to affect all of them, then now you're modifying more than one. So Unreal offers three direct ways of preventing or allowing for DRY so that you don't end up repeating yourself. And those three ways are called collapsing graph nodes, creating macros, and then creating functions. So we can skip over the collapsed graph nodes because macros and functions are kind of built off of that same principle. And so we'll kind of cover that base as we explore those. So then let's talk about macros first. A macro is just a collapsed graph of blueprint nodes. That means you take multiple nodes of, you know, functionality that you want to be able to repeat or modify in mass. And with those nodes selected, you simply right click and you collapse the macro. And when you do that, what happens is the editor will create a brand new macro in place, and you're given the opportunity to jump inside of that collapsed node. So basically, it took those nodes that we had in the other event graph, it plopped them all into here as a macro. Now, the way macros works is that when you create a macro, it's you're basically designing your own blueprint node. Let's see how to put this. You're creating all of the functionality for your own blueprint node inside of the blueprint editor itself. So as opposed to dropping down a node that says, you know, do action X, when you make a macro, you can set up as many execution pins for input and output and as many data pins that you want, which means that you're creating a custom node inside of the editor itself, which is pretty powerful once you start playing around with it. In this example, I took this add controller pitch input, which is used when the character is looking up, and that took that axis value as a parameter into A. So this is a data parameter, it's in blue, and the execution pin is in white, obviously. So if I go back into that macro, then I probably want to give it a name that makes sense. So let's just rename it to And since that in our original event graph, there's no actions that happen after this. We don't have to wire up any output pins. We only care about the input. And as soon as that input execution pin comes into this macro, it's going to flow into this function here. I'm sorry, this macro here, and from this input pin flow into here and do the same actions it was doing before. If we wanted to, we could add an output and then do some actions after, you know, this macro was completed. And in order to do that, in our details panel for our macro, we have a set of inputs and we have a set of outputs. In order to add execution pin, all you gotta do is create a new output, change its type to execution, give it a name, just call it out because that's where everything's going. And then just like in any other blueprint, we're gonna take this execution pin here, move it to the out. So now we're going to compile that. Again, hit F7 because we don't want to use the mouse as little as possible. We go back to our event graph. Now we have an output pin that we can use to do something else that we want to do. For example, we could print a string that just says, I don't know, looking up. I'm looking up, so it's spamming me output there. So that's the very, very basics of macros. You want to make macros when you care about having a custom node that supports multiple input pins and optionally multiple output pins. The other thing you can do with these macros is generally when you have a node, there are execution pins. You might have multiple ones coming in or multiple ones coming out. They're aligned at the top of the node. Well, all you got to do to fix it up here is go into where the inputs are defined, and if you drop down your execution node, just hit that up arrow there, swaps it around. Now when you go back, everything's nice and pretty. And then to illustrate the key binding that we set up earlier, we kind of want all of our nodes to be like in a nice, neat line here. We don't want, you know, a lot of spaghetti on our graph. So one of the ways that we can do that is to straighten all of the execution pins so that they all line up in a horizontal line. In order to do that, you simply select each node that you want to align, and the last node that you selected is the one that's where it's going to straighten the connections to it. So because input axis lookup rate was the last node that I selected, we have this straight connection. As you can see, since we bound a key to it, It shows up here in the tooltip. So we'll just hit Command Alt S. Did that go the other way than what I thought it would do? It went down this way, huh?
Yeah.
One, two, three. That's odd. I thought it was, let's try that a different way. It should be just straightened. Let's check that out again. Yeah, because bottom is B and top is T. And I had this working at home. Like, it was always the last node that I selected was the, let's try it with the, like that. All right, let's try that. It's weird. Oh, there we go. Well, your mileage may vary, but just play around with that. So you might be asking, okay, well, when else will we be using macros? You know, we can take repeated functionality and collapse them there. Well, we probably want something a little bit more useful than just taking some already existing nodes and turning them into a macro. We probably want something that we can use all over our code base. So what we might want to use is what's called a macro library. And a macro library allows you to hold multiple macros within it that can be referenced from any blueprint anywhere within the level. So let's just say we wanted to make a new folder here called Blueprints. I'm going to right click in here and we say Blueprint Macro Library. Now, when you make a Blueprint Macro Library, it will ask for the parent class of that macro library. So we'll pick Actor here and we'll give it a snazzy name. We'll just put my actor macro library. And when you jump into that macro library, it starts you off on a blank macro. So say that, you know, we have our third person player character who runs around, he has inputs. We might want to do something like subtract his health or give him energy or do some other actions on him. But we want to be able to grab him from anywhere in the game. We don't want to have to ask. We don't want to have to duplicate code that asks where that third person character is. And since we know that we can get any derived class, any sort of class that comes off a player character by casting it, we can make a macro that does all of that for us. And to do that, first thing obviously we're going to do is we're going to name it. We'll call it get third person character. And we need to define our inputs and outputs. Here's another thing I really recommend, especially in the context of our fake scenario of doing a game jam. Always, if you have a tooltip or if you have a description, box, just fill it in with, a brief sentence describing like what your thing does. Your other team members will definitely thank you. And you will thank yourself when you remember what the thing is that you were trying to do in the first place. So now if I hover over that, there's my tooltip there. It's as simple as that. So, since this is a macro and there's going to be code that's going to be running that needs to grab that third person character reference, we have to have an input pin. So we'll just call this one in. And since execution needs to flow past where we get the input, we'll add an output pin as well. And we'll see if this is optional in a second. So now that we have these two pins, we're going to go ahead and do our logic. So first thing we want to do is get our player controller. I'm sorry, our player character. And as you can see here, this is a pure blueprint function, so it doesn't have any input execution. The function itself is the execution when you grab its value. So we need to cast this to our third person character. So then we need a cast to come off of this. All right, now that we've got our cast, let's just kind of open this up a little bit here. And what we can also do here is, so as it stands now, there's no way for any code that uses macro to get the third person character back out of it. So in order for us to get that value back out of it, we want to add another data pin here. That is our third person character. So we'll just get a reference to that, and we'll just call that third person character. And we wire that up, and we're good to go. So now, anywhere within our code, we have the ability to come in and drop in this macro and get our third person character from our main player character without having to, you know, duplicate these two nodes, you know, everywhere else. Say, for example, later on we had some other kind of character that, you know, was running around our level, or you know, we need to add some sort of additional logic to this. All we need to do is just modify the macro and then recompile the blueprints that are affected, and then they're good to go. They work as intended. A quick note that another thing that you can do here is, because macros support multiple execution pins, I can actually come in here and say, add another pin and call it failed. And let's move that up so it lines up nicely with the other execution pin. So if the cast failed, then I can wire in that logic as well, so that the code calling this macro can do something when it can't cast, you know, appropriately. So if we compile this, I'm sorry, save it. There's one thing to note. I found this out when playing around with this. When you're actually creating a macro library, it doesn't compile until it's being used inside of another blueprint. So the only thing you have available to you is save. Now, if you're making a function, you do have the compile available to you, and we'll see why that is in a second here. So if I go back to my level blueprint, let's save this here. Just make sure we don't run afoul of anything. Now I'm in my level blueprint. Let's say I want to do something. Let's say I want to get the position of where that character is when the level starts. So I want to drop in my begin play. Again, I hold down the P key and hit and click the left mouse button to invoke that shortcut. Now I can call the macro that I created, because it's in this my actor macro library that I made. So so there's our macro there. We grab that. We have its input. And we have our data pin, which will be the output of that third person character. Let's say we want to print that character's location to the screen. We'll get its transform. And we want to print that to the screen. The editor popped in this handy dandy conversion node for us, so we didn't have to do extra work. So now I'm gonna compile this and play. Oh, we still got our looking up in there, huh? Kind of killed all our output here. So let's go and remove that. and there's our transform as printed by that. So now we can drop in that macro any place in code in order to get a reference to this player character that we have. So when should you use macros? When you don't have functionality that should be called from another blueprint. So for example, if your macro can be used anywhere, or it can be used solely within a single blueprint that doesn't need to be accessed from within any other blueprint, then that's probably a good candidate to use a macro as opposed to a function or some other mechanism. And of course, you want to use a macro when you have multiple input or output execution pins. Functions, as we'll discuss next, only support a single input and a single output. And their functions are meant to be used on called on blueprints directly. So we'll talk about those next. Is everybody good so far? Am I moving too fast, or is everything good to go? You can have multiple data pins that are inputs to your function, but your function only has like one, let's call it entry point. A macro can have multiple entry points. So for example, say you had a branch statement and then you wanted to call a macro after that. You could have your true execution pin coming off into one of those pins, and then your false into another one. And inside your macro, you can do something based on which input you got from the blueprint, how the blueprint called you. So functions are the same as macros in that they're a collapsed graph of blueprint nodes. You can create them in a similar way. You can either let's go to our third person character. You can either make a new function by clicking this add function here. You can grab a bunch of nodes and right click as we did earlier with the macro example. You know, we're not going to do this here, but if we wanted to, we'd grab these, right-click, and then collapse the function. Then that function will already be pre-populated with these nodes. And you can create a function via a blueprint function library. It doesn't really matter. It just depends on like your workflow and whether or not you're cleaning up code, whether you're adding new code or whatever. It doesn't really make a difference how you create it. And just like with macros, blueprint functions can be reused across all blueprints inside of all of your code. So you know, if you put your function inside of a blueprint function library, then you can access it from anywhere, which again makes it very useful to use that for utility functions and other global logic that doesn't really rely on any specific blueprint. Now, if you have logic that only relies on blueprints and you want to be able to call that logic from some other blueprint or the level itself, then you're going to want to put that function inside of the blueprint class that you define, because you have quick access to what's called self, which is the blueprint that is currently running that function. And just by way of example, let's kind of do the same thing we did with that macro that we made. Let's make a function just so we can see how these are constructed that does pretty much the same thing, but we'll see what the differences are. So we'll go back and we'll make a new function library. And as you see, we didn't get a pop-up asking what the parent class was. That's because functions, again, they're independent of any blueprint, unless they're actually bound to a specific blueprint. So we'll just call some my function library. It immediately starts us off on a brand new function. Because this is a function and not a macro, in that library I can give it the same name that I gave the other one. We're just doing this so that we can see how this works. So there's a couple things that are different than when we were designing the macro. The first thing you might notice over here on the side is that we renamed our function, but underneath this is a local variables view here. And when Justin gave his presentation, he talked a bit about, you know, variables and how they're used inside of blueprints. But what makes this interesting is that you can have variables that you use to store the results of computations or active references or whatever you want inside of your function that are totally hidden away or encapsulated from the code that's calling the function itself. So, for example, you could grab a value, for example, a reference to our third-person character, and then you can make a variable and then store that off there. And then if that variable exists the next time that function is called, you just return a reference from there, which may optimize your code. But there's plenty of other uses for having local variables inside of a function. So we have our entry point, which is this purple node right here. And we want to do the same thing we did with the macro. So we want to, well, I guess the first thing we want to do is get our player character. And we want to cast that to our third person player character. Wire by our execution here. So now we need to return this third person character reference back to the code that's calling into this function. So in order to do that, we just need to set up a what's called a return node. Return node is just simply a simplified view of the output node that we saw in our macro. So we grab a return node. As you can see, it already has like an execution pin. You can't add any more. For example, if I go over here and I want to create an output, there is no exec in here because functions only support one means of entry and one means of exit. It's, the same thing goes here. I can't. There's no exec, so I can only have one entry and one exit to a function. So what we want to return is a data pin that is our third person character. So we'll just go ahead and add that here. Get that reference. And compile. Compile means save to us now. And wire that in. Okay, why is my note still there? What's that? Oh. No, because since we only have one output execution pin, it's the same execution pin. No, and then so I note that this is a note, which this is optional. I don't remember like getting this earlier, but. Oh, with it there? Yeah, I think that's what it's going to do.
But the problem with doing that is if your cast fails, you don't have a reference.
Right. And it's up to you to determine, you know, in this example, this is like a case where it's not ever really going to fail as long as we know that. If it fails. If it does fail, that means that this third person character will be set to null and things will break later on. But that's why it's a note and not a warning, as far as I know. If we were to, you know, it didn't give that up to us on our macro because we wired it up to like a fail condition. But I wanted to point out too that what you can do with functions is convert it into a pure function. And in Unreal, a pure function, this kind of delves into C++ a little bit, but it's a function that doesn't require an explicit execution input node. So if you make a function pure, we saw that a little bit earlier, or we see that right in front of us here with this get player character. It doesn't have an input node saying, I need to get this player character for somewhere. That's because it's a pure function. So when we make this function pure, that means that we can just drop in this function and then grab the third person character result off of it. We don't have to have execution flowing into it at all, which makes it handy for cases of, you know, when you're grabbing, you know, data that doesn't change often, you know, like a reference to a global thing like your game mode or a player character or something like that. So those are our basic building blocks for, you know, implementing DRY and making sure that we have a single point that we can go in and modify either a macro or a function. We know the differences between the two. So from there, what we can do is we can just start playing around with some examples as we move into the next section. So we have our map here. We have our guy. We run around and jump. Not a whole lot interesting things going on here, but it would be fun to, like, you know, wire up some key events and just get things happening, because, you know, we have some ideas we want to try out. And one of the ways we can do that is we can wire up events that that cause other things to happen on other blueprints outside of the ones that we're executing on. And what I mean by that is we basically can communicate from one blueprint to another and add that to our toolbox for something that we can use to be able to prototype faster. So we'll just run through a quick example so you guys can see what I'm talking about here. So say, you know, because we want to wire up some debug keys here and we hit the F key. Well, first of all, let's just take a step back here. We started this project with the starter content. And starter content, if you guys have played around with it, there's just a ton of fun stuff in here that you can use to quickly, you know, add objects, meshes, particles, audio, etc., into your level. For example, if you like burning things, you can take this fire blueprint, and now we have a fire somewhere in our level. some Beavis and Butthead jokes back there. We have all these different shapes that come into starter content, from, you know, cube, cylinders, etc., etc. So let's say that you know, we're playing around and we kind of want we want the character to run through a trigger, and then I don't know, maybe a fire pops up somewhere. And one way that we could do that is we could start off by, let's see, we're in basic mode here. We have a box trigger. Oops. So let's just drag a trigger out. Let's just put them at the top of the stairs here. Not quite top of the stairs. There you go. That's more like it. So I have this trigger here, but I need this trigger to do something. When we run across it, I want it to spawn a fire, like somewhere on a level where I place it on a level. So this trigger by itself is not going to really do anything, because it's just that. It's just a trigger. So what I can do with this trigger is I can turn it into a blueprint, and then I can actually add, you know, functionality to it. So let's go ahead and do that. There's this button over here with my trigger selected. It's blueprint add script. Let's click that. And the editor will ask you where you want to save that new blueprint, and you can give it a name. It's already kind of given us a useful name for it, so we'll just go ahead and create that. And it pops us into the blueprint editor with the trigger already in our viewport. So this is a little bit of a time saver, because if you have, you know, triggers, meshes, what have you, you can place those in a level, and when you decide that you want them to be able to interact with other objects, you can turn those into blueprints and then go ahead and add in all of the logic that you need to from there. So we want this particular box trigger to activate some other actor that we have in a level once the player runs over it. So in order to do that, maybe the first thing we want to do is we want to add a new variable, which is the actor that we want to trigger once the player runs over this. So we'll call this target actor. And we'll make that an actor reference. As a matter of fact, we're going to make this a specific actor reference, and we'll see why in a second here. There's that fire actor that I dropped in earlier is called blueprint effect fire. So we'll make that actor have to be a reference to that, or sorry, blueprint effect fire. And then we'll compile. And we'll give it a tooltip so that we know what it is. So now that we have that variable in place, we can start writing some scripts around it. So let's go over to our event graph and what we want to do is there's this collision component in here, and this collision component has events that we can use to determine whether or not this trigger is being interacted with, which is when you run over a trigger, it's called an overlap, and then when you run into it, it's a begin overlap, and then when you exit it, it's called an end overlap. So we want to be able to pull those events off and then be able to do some scripting with those. In order to do that, we take this little eyeball thing here, and we say show inherited variables. And there's our collision component there. If we right-click on that and say add event. So here's all the events that we can use on that collision component, which is the one we want, is begin overlap. So this will get fired off when the player runs into this trigger. So we have a target actor, we have this event that's gonna get fired off, and we wanna be able to do something with that actor. We already know that this actor is that blueprint effect fire. So let's take a look at that right quick to see what we have available on it. Let's save this. So I'm still really nervous that I'm going to get a crash at some point here. So let's track down that blueprint. Here's blueprint effect fire. Let's open it up, see what we got. Looks like we have a couple components in here. We have this fire particle, and then we have audio that is the effect of the fire playing itself. So those are some things that we can play around with. And because we're messing around with starter content, and we might want to do some other fire effects later, and we want to start out with this effect being deactivated, meaning that we want to drop this actor into the level, but not have the fire going and not have the audio playing. So what we'll do is we'll take this and we'll copy it over into our blueprints folder out of the starter content. And we'll change the name so that we can distinguish it from the other one that we had. So we'll just call it deactivated. We'll open that up. And as you can see, here's our cool looking fire particle with the audio. But again, we want this to start deactivated. So we'll go in here, we'll grab this fire component, scroll down until we see activation, and we'll turn off auto activation. We'll do the same thing with the audio so that we don't hear it until it's actually activated, because we don't want it to activate until we run over it with that trigger. We'll go ahead and compile. Now if we go back over to our trigger here, we know that our target actor is going to be blueprint effect fire. So what we want to do is we want to go and actually place that node inside of our level. which will be the actual node that gets activated. There we go. Oh, put me here, Unreal. All right. So we'll grab this guy. Let's just put him in front of you. Say he's like a hazard. Got to figure out some other way around him. So we'll put that there. As you can see, if I play this level, run up the steps, there's actually nothing happening here. Another useful thing that we can do here is we can go in to our trigger box, and we can grab this this component, and we can say after hitting game, we can turn that off. We do that, and we play again. We can at least, for debugging purposes, see where our trigger is at, so we know when we're interacting with our trigger or not. So we have our deactivated actor in the level, and now we need to go ahead and trigger it. So to do that, we're going to be doing some direct blueprint communication, which is the entire point of setting this example up. So when the component is overlapped, meaning the player runs into it, we're going to take, it's currently selected right now. So here's that input cord I was telling you that was left off of all the other input maps. We just need to drop a reference to this into our blueprint. So we'll hit R and then we'll click. Actually, you know what? Maybe that only applies on level blueprints. I might have gotten that backwards. All right, so let's just do this the normal way. So we'll grab our box trigger, and we have I missed another step too. So let's go back. Let's compile this so it saves. What I forgot to do was I forgot to take this target actor and make it editable. This is what allows it to show up in the details panel. When we go to edit it inside of the level editor. So there it is, now it's shown up. So now we can go ahead and grab our I guess because this doesn't inherit from that one, I can't use this actor for that purpose. So I probably shouldn't have did the copy. I probably should have did. Yeah. So let's do that. Let's go and update our class to be this guy. Pile. There it is. Oops. So now we have our target actor set. We can go ahead and wire in the logic to activate it. So that's pretty straightforward. We want to activate the actor. Unreal users to use Mac. Answer me a question right quick. So when I drag off a node, I have to hit tab 3 times in order to get to the search. That's Mac only. That is very, very annoying. All right, good to know. Yeah, maybe it's in 4.12. Maybe that's been fixed. So we want to activate this actor. So let's go ahead and grab a reference to our target actor. So here's another little quick optimization. It's very minor. Normally you drag a variable to your graph, it'll ask you if you want to get or set it. Well, if you know that all you need to do is get the value, then you hold down, on Windows, you hold down the control key, on Mac you hold down the command key, you drag it out, and it automatically makes it a getter, as opposed to asking you that question.
You can drag it straight to that target, or you can go straight to the wire.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you can drag target.
over to, maybe not on Mac. Oh, Mac's getting left out. Let's see if I hold down control at the command if that happens. Yeah.
Oh, because you know
what?
That
activated first. Oh, I grabbed the wrong. I grabbed the wrong one. Whoops. Oh no no yeah. Mike's right. You know he's right. That was the right one. Sorry. Yeah, I got to grab the components here, and that's what we're gonna. Right, I got you. Okay, that's good to know. All right, so we're going to grab those components that we want to activate. If you remember in the deactivated one, we deactivated two. We deactivated the audio and then the particle itself. So then that means that we need to reactivate both of those. So we'll grab off P fire for the particle effect. We'll also grab the fire audio. And then we'll put those up in there, and we will clean up a little bit. So I want to take this a little moment here to let's just do a little bit of cleanup here, because even though, like, you know, aligning those and then cleaning up takes a little bit of time, it saves you time in the long run because you don't end up with a bunch of spaghetti that you can't decipher later. So all we'll do here is we'll grab these five nodes here, and we'll hit the C key, which turns it into a comment block. So we'll say activate on overlap. And then the other thing why that makes that useful is that you can just take this entire comment block and then drag it around. It drags around all enclosed nodes, as opposed to you having to select every single or all of them together and then move them around that way. But yeah, anytime you have any sort of like tiny bit of logic, you want to add a comment node around it to let you know what you're doing there, but then also make it easier to kind of rearrange and move things around as you need to. So now that we have this activate on overlap, we should be able to compile and play. And there's our trigger, so let's see what happens when we run into it. And then our fire shows up. Yay. So we could go ahead and We could go ahead and wire in some logic that when we left the trigger box that the fire goes away or do some other kind of, but that's just to demonstrate, you know, communicating from one blueprint to another. We took our box trigger that we dragged into a level, we turned it into a blueprint, and then we added another blueprint and created a reference to it, and then we directly manipulated the target blueprint from our original blueprint. And that's just to get the basics of that down. So building on top of that, another way that we can communicate from a blueprint to another blueprint, or from our level blueprint to other blueprints, is by using event dispatchers. And an event dispatcher is just the way that, you know, you, the coder going in, creates your own custom events that can be fired off from any given blueprint and executed on another blueprint. So it's another way of communicating, but it allows you to create multiple events that you can use to trigger various different things. So let's go through setting up an event dispatcher in our little prototyping level here. So let's say that we want to test out like some abilities for our player character. We don't necessarily have all of our, you know, inputs mapped out. We don't know what keyboard keys or joystick keys are going to be used to do everything, but let's just say that our character has the ability to create fire, to set things on fire. I guess we want to keep going around that, down that Beavis and Butthead route, and we'll do it that way. So what we can do is We can set up an event dispatcher that is triggered when you hit the input key of F for fire, that causes our third person character here to set a fire to something. So let's see how we would set that up. Because the event is being handled by our third person character here, let's track him down. First, let's just do a little bit of cleanup here. We got a lot of tabs open. And that is playing with fire, no pun intended. This is our level blueprint. We don't really need anything here right now, so. We'll leave that open. So here's our third person character. Let's get a little better view. Move this to the side. We don't need all that space right now. So in the starter template, we already have some gamepad input, touch input, jumping, mouse input, look controls, all that good stuff. So we want to go ahead and we want to wire in an event that gets handled by this third person character to start fires. So what we'll do is we'll go over here and look at our event dispatchers. Now, we have all these other things in because we turned on this show inherited variables. We don't need that at the moment, so we'll go ahead and get rid of that, have a little nicer look here. So we'll add a new event dispatcher, and we'll call that start fire. So what we want to do is, anytime the user presses the F key is when we want to start fire. So let's see how we'd go about doing that. So obviously, first thing we're going to do is we're going to add an event for the F key. Let's zoom in a little bit here. Oh, just another little pro tip. If you hit the home button inside the graph, it will center it on whatever currently selected node that you have. So we want this F key to trigger our start fire. So we'll grab our new event dispatcher and drag it to the grid, and we want to call it when you hit the F key. So every time you press F, it'll call start fire. And what you want to note here is that, like, the target here is self. So events, since they're another means of communicating across blueprints, the target of an event does not have to be the blueprint where the event was created. It can be another blueprint that handles that event as well. But to keep things simple, starting off, we'll just leave things the way they are here. So let's do a little bit more setup. Let's compile this. We got some props in here, something we might want to set on fire. I don't know if you are the religious type, but we have a bush here. So why don't we just set this bush on fire? Why not? So our bush is selected here. It's just a static mesh. It's not a blueprint on its own. And we don't actually need it to be a blueprint. We can just leave it as it is. But what we want to do is we want to go into our level blueprint at this point. And we want to handle what happens when that start fire event is called on that player character. So we'll go into our level blueprint here. And I think now we'll finally get to use that handy dandy input cord. Let's get a reference to that bush and drop in a level. We're going to hold down the R key and hit left mouse button. And there's a reference to our bush. The reason why we got that reference, again, is because it's currently selected. If we had something else selected and hit that, that's what would show up in this map here. So now that we have a reference to it, we need to get our third person character so that we can actually bind that event that it gets generated so that we can actually handle it within this level blueprint. So let's just do it by way of example. So earlier on, we created a macro and we created a function that allowed us to get our third person character. So since we have those available, we might as well use those now. There's our macro, there's our function, but let's try our function since it's pure and it's simple. And as you can see, as we were talking about before, we don't have any input or output execution pins because we made it into a pure function. If we go back and edit it and, you know, make it unpure, you would see execution pins going in and out. So we have our third person character reference here. So what we want to do is we want to assign our start fire event, which is binding the start fire event. I believe that Justin touched upon this on his talk, but I don't know why, you know, the names don't really match up with the nodes that you get out of it, but just keep that in mind. You could also gotten to it by just typing in start fire and then finding out assign as well. But just keep in mind you're going to be assigning this event in order to bind to it. So one thing that we need to go ahead and take care of now, I love to delete it for whatever reason. We still need our begin play because we have to wire in this event when the level starts. So we'll hold down P and left mouse click to get that begin play. We'll wire that into our bind. And so binding the event will just receive events off of the third player character when it fires off that start fire. What actually is a result of that, what actually gets triggered is this custom event that was created for us, start fire event 0. So this is what's actually going to get triggered once the player hits the F key to attempt to burn that bush. So from here, we want to spawn a fire where that bush is. So I think it's just simple enough to just spawn that actor, which you already know is that So here's our blueprint effect fire. No, that's not what I want. What's that? Oh yeah, thank you. There's our fire. All right, there we go. All right, so we need to figure out, we want to spawn this fire on this bush that we dropped in the level. So obviously that means we got to get the transform for this bush so we know where to spawn the fire. Yeah, I could also get the location. You know what? That actually might be simple in this case. So we don't care about rotation or scale. So we'll just grab a location since that'll plug in directly into the spawn location. But you know what? I have a feeling that that fire might be a little bit too low if we spawn it directly on top of this bush. So why don't we go ahead and bump it up a notch. So what we'll do here is we'll add 100 units to the Z. And then we'll take that and we'll plug it in to there. And see if we got everything that we need here. I think so. I think we have everything that we need in order to. Yeah, I must have grabbed the wrong one. Let's try that again. Ah, there it is. Yeah. Thank you. All right, let's grab our class.
cool one here is if you right click on the spawn transform.
Yeah.
Split that down, and then it'll just give you the
All right. Let's move this out of the way again. All right, so when the level starts playing, it'll bind that third-person character start fire event, and when that event fires, it will go ahead and it'll spawn this fire effect on top of the bush that we have, translating it up 100 units. So let's see if this works out. All right, there's our bush. I'm gonna hit the F key, and there we go. Good stuff. Okay, so that's just a simple example of what you can do with event dispatchers. You can tie those to a individual blueprint, bind to that event, and then later on react to that event. So that's all well and good, but say we have things in our level that can be destroyed, but they can be, for example, say you have, some sort of AI or minion that can be destroyed, but then you have like a crate that can be destroyed or something like that. We don't want to just be adding the same event dispatcher over and over and over again for each different blueprint class. We want kind of a cleaner way of being able to fire off events that destroy things, but be able to apply those to any blueprint that we want. So one way that we can do that is called an interface. And what an interface is it's a set of functions that a blueprint chooses to implement that can be called as events from other blueprints. So let's just illustrate that so that we can see what that looks like. Let's say we started a fire. That's all good, but I like breaking stuff too. This is a game. It's like an action game. It's a future of games. So let's see. Let's look around and see if we have anything in our starter content that we could break. Well, we have this this glass window. It's a static mesh, but that looks like something we could break. So why don't we right-click that? And we'll create a destructible mesh out of it. And it immediately creates a destructible mesh glass, but we got to make sure that the thing actually breaks. So we'll go into that. And here's our mesh here, ready to be broken. So we'll just say fracture mesh. What's that? What was it? Oh. Great. Let's see if brightness will help. It's not. It's just the projector itself. Well, take my word for it that there it is. Yeah. I don't know if there's a way to like change this background at all, but yeah. Well, I fractured it. It's fractured. Trust me, it's fractured. All right. So we have a glass window destructible mesh. Let's go back. So we have this guy, but it's a destructible mesh. But we want to be able to destroy it somehow. And you can't just do that with a mesh. So obviously, it needs to be a blueprint. So we want to turn this into a blueprint. Before we saw that you could drag something into a level. For example, there's this bush still, which is still a static mesh, I could say, add script, and it turns it into a blueprint. But what if you have something in the content browser that you also want to turn into a blueprint? Just right-click on it and go to Asset Actions, and you say Create Blueprint Using This. So then it'll bring up a pop-up. It'll allow you to rename it by convention, either like underscore blueprint or underscore BP on the end of these, so I can distinguish them between other types of assets. Our blueprints folder is already selected, so let's go ahead and create that blueprint there. It pops us into this editor. Hopefully you can see that a little bit better. So there's our destructible mesh in there. So we have this mesh in here, but we want to know if we can destroy it. And if we can destroy it, we might want to pass some properties to it that, you know, allow us to destroy it in certain ways. So let's see here. In our blueprints folder, we're going to create a new interface. And we'll call that a DM interface, for destructible mesh interface. And this actually is taken from some of the documentation on Unreal's website. So this isn't, you can actually go on there and play around with this yourself. They use it in their first person example, but I didn't really want to bother with that, so we'll play around with it in our third person example. All right, so we create our interface, we load it up, and what's this here? It looks like we have the ability to create a new function. Well, with an interface, you create functions, but your functions don't actually have logic. They're just a template that you can use to implement on other blueprints that implement this interface. So if that sounds a little bit confusing, we'll just do an example there. So we'll create a new function on this interface, and we'll call that isDestructible. Compile. And we want to define our inputs and outputs for this destructible. Let's see, we could have damage, which is like how much damage is being done to the thing that is destructible. So we'll make that a float. We could have hit location, which is the spot that was actually hit, which is reported by whoever hit the destructible item. Make that a vector. And I don't know, let's have like strength. This is like, your impact force or something like that. Make that a float as well. So now we have this interface, this destructible mesh interface with this isDestructible function on it. So going back over to our blueprint here, we want this blueprint to be able to handle this that interface. So what we do is we go over to class settings, and under interfaces you see that something called implemented interfaces. We'll add our new interface here, which basically tells Unreal that this blueprint here can accept functions being called off of that destructible mesh interface. So it can handle isDestructible. So let's compile that. And let's go over to our event graph. So we want to respond to, we want to respond to some other piece of code saying that our mesh is destructible. So we'll add an event. Is destructible. And from there, so let me do this properly. I believe apply damage. Yeah, there we go. So we have our destructible. It's already added a reference for us. Thank you very much, Unreal. Actually, you know what? I don't know if this is the one I want. One second, because I forgot which one I'm actually supposed to use to wire in the applied damage. So let's go back to... You said it's coming from the interface? Yeah. This icon here? Oh, okay, I see. Yeah, that's the part that's got me thrown off. I'm sorry, what's that? Oh, you know what? Yeah. Thank you very much. That's probably what happened there. I knew that looked like weird. All right, let's do that again. Error. Ah, there we go. Thank you. All right, so now we want to apply damage whenever we see that event. So we can take in this damage amount. We can actually use this hit location and the impulse direction. Leave that the same value, and then we can plug in this impulse strength. So one thing that's kind of interesting to note about this is that these are technically optional. We can make another blueprint actor that implements this destructible interface that just simply responds in its own way to, let's compile, let's get rid of that error. There we go. So these don't necessarily have to be supplied, but like if they are and you can use them, then we can go ahead and use it. So given that we have that, let's go ahead and see about wiring that up. So, this probably needs like a frame or something, but you know what? Now, we need a way to call that is destructible, you know, when we act in order to break this mesh apart, break this glass. And since we're prototyping and, you know, we're not trying to flesh out everything now, we'll bind that to another key. So we'll go back to our level blueprint. And we will, first of all, we'll grab a reference to this guy. He's already selected. So we'll just hit R, get reference to that. Let's not be so janky in here. Move around a little bit. All right, so with C, so we can make it all nice and spiffy. And we will we'll have the B key break our glass. So when the B key is pressed, what we want to do is we want to go ahead and fire off that event to our glass window. So what we'll do is let's zoom in a little bit. I can't even see that myself. All right. So we'll pass this message along, and we need to use the reference to our breakable glass as the target. And we can set these values in if we want, but for now, let's just see if we can get this working. So let's compile this. At all. Let's just put like, I don't know, yeah, that's good. That's a good number, 100. 100 is always good.
And then at one point, they have issues with this
on the map. Oh, yeah. Oh, boy, here we go.
I was going to say it again.
All right, let's give it a shot. So there's our thing. Now let's hit B. And nothing happens. So let's see what we can do. What's that? No, maybe I need the, let's try strength next, and if not, we'll try hit location. Still nothing, nada. What's that now? Yeah, that's a good call. Let's go over and let's set a breakpoint over in. I'm gonna need you to go away. Let's set a breakpoint here. Hit F9. That breakpoint there. And just to make sure that everything's going through the flow that we expect it to, we'll set a breakpoint here as well. All right, now, that's right, we've got to compile. Does. They still have asterisks on them. All right, I guess, yeah, since it didn't need to compile, it doesn't want to save, so that's kind of goofy. Thank you. Keep getting that. All right, so let's hit B and see what happens. All right, so it hit this here. So let's go ahead and step. All right. Yeah, it would be great to see it break though. But maybe like the fact that these are zero, because we do have our damage of 100 and our impulse strength of 100. Our target is good to go. So let's just try one more test, and you're right, I mean, we did illustrate this, but let's see if we can actually get the break, because, you know. Inside of this blueprint, it should be, okay. Yeah, it should be this here. Yeah. Because I'm pretty sure there's a component right there. It's the same component. All right, so we'll try it one more time, and we'll just we'll pass in a value for hit location. Let's just give these I don't know. Oops, not what I wanted to do. Now we'll get rid of this breakpoint here. And this one over here. Since we know those values are coming through. All right, here we go. Well, doesn't mean it's been fixed, especially on a Mac. Huh. All right, I'll have to look into that then. That's disappointing, but that could be. But well, yeah, as we saw that, you know, we were able to create our interface, we were able to give it, I mean, we could go ahead and spend some time wiring up another one, but I think that demonstrates, like, how you can use interfaces. I mean, if I wanted to, I could add an isDestructible to, for example, I could take this bush and turn it into a blueprint, have it implement the isDestructible interface, and do something like when that fire gets applied to it, go ahead and, you know, make it get destroyed, make it disappear or something along those lines. Maybe emit more smoke particles or something like that once that gets fired off. Everything, yeah. I think in that case, I would grab everything and put it in an array, right? Like find all actors with interface or something like that. Let's just see like what nodes we would use for that. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, and then you can do like a for each, and if we look at our cheat sheet, for each is just. Oh, who's that? Since, oh, thank you. Yeah. Right. Yeah, you can use interfaces to actually query as well. Like you can have a function on an interface that returns a value. Right. Like let's go back to our DM interface just to show you what we have there. I can easily go in here and set up outputs that are required on this interface. So say I need to return some float value, which is like, I don't know, like damage output or something like that. So that way, you know, you can call something on this interface and then query this damage output value to use somewhere else. So that's, you can use it in either way. All right, so let's just do a quick wrap-up review here. In the beginning, we talked about you know, getting to know your key bindings and making sure you had your key bindings set up based on your workflow. Unreal allows you to set up key bindings for pretty much every single action in the editor. As you can see here, so there's plenty to explore here. Understand how to use macros and functions and what the differences are between them. We talked about how macros support multiple input and output execution pins, whereas functions only support one of each. However, they both support as many data pins as you want to tack onto them. And functions can also be turned into a pure function, which alleviates the need to have input and output pins on the function itself. Know the ways that you can communicate between blueprints. We had an example where we took a blueprint that was our box trigger, and we had a reference to another blueprint, and we directly manipulated that blueprint once that box trigger was overlapped. Also know when you should create event dispatchers. If you have some sort of blueprint that can only respond to a certain event, it might not make sense to make an interface because that blueprint might be the only thing that you know, uses that event. So in that case, you use an event dispatcher to be able to both bind from another blueprint and then react to that event within that blueprint itself. And then finally, know when you should use interfaces to take common logic and be able to implement it in different types of blueprint actors so that you can call that from various other blueprints and expect a similar result. And that's pretty much it. Does anybody have any questions? Sure. So if we go back out to our level, if my, all right, see, we did well. At least we got through the whole thing. Oh, boy.
Real quick, I think I found when we're doing direct communication, essentially you did it where you set the variable, you type in the name of the blueprint you want. Unreal has a weird setting that, I mean, it's probably preferable in most cases, but I'm not sure where it's triggering it. I don't know if it's removing the execution and leading up to it, but it will reset that default. So if you're in debugging mode and you're into the zone,
yeah,
you can be like, oh, this should be working, and then, oh, wait, defaults detached. So watch out on that. It is the most annoying thing ever.
Do you think it's because I noticed that even if it float like variable, you have to hit compile as soon as you name the variable and set its type. Otherwise, like, it won't respect the default that you put in there.
But even if you do hit compile, sometimes it'll detach your defaults that you have.
Okay.
If it's a direct communication between blueprints.
Right.
So watch out on that because that gets really annoying sometimes.
Got you. It's good to know. Yeah. Yeah, Josh was asking about that. Well, here, we'll quit. Because, I think I had enough of me for one evening. Which is, hey, at least it didn't crash, you know. It was crashing a lot on me earlier, so. But what Josh was pointing out was that within your project, where's our fast prototyping? For your game itself, you can set key binding. So, you know, I was setting up, you know, I was directly saying, oh, the F key does this and the B key does this. You can set up your input actions under your project settings. Sure, restore them, even though I should have had a clean exit. Input. So you have these action mappings and axis mappings. Actions correspond to digital inputs, and axis, I believe, is your analog inputs. So let's see what we have here. So we have jump, which is already set up for us in this template project, which is when you hit the space bar, your guy jumps. And then you have all of these axis mappings, which will correspond to a joystick or the keyboard. If you drop these down, well, there you go. You see that to move forward, each of these keys applies a scale, which is used in the blueprint to determine which direction you're going to be moving in. And also, the left thumbstick on a gamepad, a joystick, will do the same thing. So here you can add as many arbitrary axis and action mappings as you want for your particular project. And those correspond, let me show you where those correspond to. If we go back into our third person character blueprint. So let's say we wanted to make a fire input action. Well, we can go back. And that's going to be a digital input, so we'll just say plus, we'll call it fire, or start fire, whatever. And we'll tie that to F. Yeah, there we go. All right, so there we go. So now we have that binding. So if we go back over into our third person character, instead of doing this, just say, oh, yeah, thank you. Call our action event here. Compile. Oh, here's one more thing to note that I found while, you know, rehearsing this in different projects. That setting, that editor preferences setting for saving the blueprint when you hit compile, that's per project. I don't know why it's like mapped on the global preferences, but this is something to keep in mind that you gotta set that up again, which is, yeah. So just keep that in mind. So let's go ahead and save this. And just to make sure that we're actually like hitting the right input event, we'll go ahead and set a breakpoint there. And compile that, play. When we hit F, there's our input action that we created. So that way you can go in and you can change your mappings later in your input bindings without having it hard coded to specific keys or joystick buttons. So that's what that's useful for. Exactly. Thank you, Josh. All right, any more questions? Mm-hmm. Industry. Mm-hmm. Oh, congrats. That is Kings and Heroes. All right. We'll check that out then. Okay. Yeah, cool. We'll check that out. Thank you. All right, well, with that, that concludes our meetup, and we do not have anybody slated for next month. The deal is that if we don't have a speaker, then Justin and I trade off, which is cool, but it'd be great to have one of you come up here and present on whatever you're interested in. So please come and talk to us, let us know, shoot us an email, get on Slack, and we will set that up for you, and then we'll get that announcement out. And let everybody know what's going on. So, all right, thank you.